This is Duke University.
Thank you. Grace and peace to you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, and welcome to the service of worship today. We're so glad to have you with us. This last week has been Duke's spring break, and I'm happy to report that the chapel mission trips to Honduras and Costa Rica and New Mexico have all returned safely in the last day, so thank you for your prayers. I'd also like to welcome our guest choir, whom you've already heard, the Gate City Young Singers. They are from Greensboro and the surrounding areas and have traveled this morning to be with us, and as you've already seen, they will be a blessing to our worship today. I'd also like to mention that the Durham Crop Walk is this afternoon, starting at 2:30. We'll leave from the chapel lawn. The Durham Crop Walk is one of the biggest crop walks in the nation, and it is a way to raise money for world hunger. If you are interested in joining and being part of the walk, just look for Brad Troxel and the congregation youth on the chapel lawn, and you'd be welcome to walk with the congregation team. And finally, I've been joking that we have a rebel bishop in our midst. The bishop of the Helsingør Diocese of Denmark, Bishop Lise-Lotte Rebel, is here with us today as our guest preacher. She is the first woman to be named bishop of the Danish Church, and it is quite a gift to have her in our midst and to hear the things that God will say to us through her. And now let us stand and sing God's praises.
Thank you. We fly to the bosom of Jesus, lover of our souls, so that we may find a safe haven for our hearts. And there we confess our sin before God. Let us pray together. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways for the glory of your name. Amen. For as the heavens are high above the earth, so great is God's steadfast love towards us. As far as the east is from the west, so far God removes our transgressions from us. Because of God's great mercy, I declare that in Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Thanks be to God. And as a forgiven people, we not only receive God's peace in Christ, but we are called to share that peace with one another. And so this morning, I invite you to share signs of peace, whether it be a handshake, a hug, or a holy kiss. And at this moment, I invite you to share the peace of Christ with one another.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination. Gracious Father, you gave up your Son out of love for the world. As your word is read in our midst, lead us to ponder the mysteries of his passion, that we may know eternal peace through the shedding of our Savior's blood, Jesus Christ. The first lesson is from Philippians, the third chapter. If anyone else has reason to be confident in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, a member of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew born of Hebrews. As to the law, a Pharisee. As to zeal, a persecutor of the church. As to righteousness under the law, blameless. Yet whatever gains I had, these I have come to regard as loss because of Christ. More than that, I regard everything as loss because of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things, and I regard them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but one that comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God based on faith. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the sharing of his sufferings by becoming like him in his death, if somehow I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained this or have already reached the goal, but I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Beloved, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on towards the goal for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
The gospel lesson is from John, the 12th chapter. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. There they gave a dinner for him. Martha served, and Lazarus, one of those at the table, was one of the at the table with him. Mary took a pound of costly perfume made of pure nard, anointed Jesus' feet, and wiped them with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, the one who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He kept the common purse and used to steal what was put into it. Jesus said, "Leave her alone. She bought it so that she might keep it for the day of my burial. You always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me." This is the word of the Lord.
Thank you. Let us pray. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Dear congregation, I have looked forward to celebrating worship with you in this wonderful cathedral, because I have an acknowledgement I cannot live without. I cannot live without hearing the gospel, without gathering around songs of praise and prayer, the Eucharist and baptism. Living without these would make life empty and meaningless. I share the same feeling that have been described in the novel Night Train to Lisbon by Pascal Mercier. In the book, there is a fantastic speech about the contradiction which the church serves to provide word and room for. The speech is given by an intelligent student who is only 70 years old. The student is struggling with the Christian faith. He is in doubt, but he cannot let go of this struggle. The 17 years old describe, "I could not live in a world without cathedrals. I need their beauty and grandeur. I need it against the mixed gray shades of the uniforms. I want to hear the rustling of the organ. I need it as a counterweight against the shrill farce of march music. I want to read the powerful words of the Bible. I need it against the dilapidation of the language and the dictatorships of slogans. A world without these things would be a world that I would not like to live in." So far, the 17 years old. He claims with a clear sight of youth that the world would be different if it did not have the contradiction that the church is here to express. We would be poor even if we owned everything, if we didn't have the church and the gospel. No, I would not be able to live in a world without cathedrals. It has not always been this way for me. I come from a family which wasn't particularly oriented towards the church. We were baptized and members, but going to church was not part of the life of our family. It wasn't something we missed either. But something happened. I was 16 years old and had just entered high school. My dad was very proud. I was the first person in our family to make it that far. Unfortunately, my father died only a couple of months later. The world turned dark. Life stopped. The grief sent me out into those questions that I have heard from so many since then. Why God? Why God, if you do exist? Why couldn't you prevent what happened? My anger and powerlessness was aimed toward the God whom I barely knew, but who had to be there as a guarantee for a happy life. Only slowly did I reach a turning point. My old confirmation pastor helped me. He asked me so gently, "Who is the God who you are so angry at?" Carefully and lovingly, he showed me toward the God who is the Lord of the Church, Jesus Christ. That was when I realized that we only know God where God himself shows us who he is. And he does so through a little child who was born in a stable, through the crucified and resurrected Lord Jesus Christ, who cried out his own pain and trial at the cross. That is where God is. The God who alone has the right to be honored and worshiped. The God who knows all that is human and will be with us in everything in our lives. It is so different from everything that we can figure out for ourselves. It is a very different speech about God than that we find in other religions. In Christianity, God himself tells us who he is. A God who lives, suffers, cries, and dies with us. When Jesus stood wearing a crown of thorns in front of the crowd that yelled, "Crucify him," Pilate said about Jesus, "Behold the man." The Christian church confesses, "Yes, see your Lord and your God." So great is the divinity of God that he bows down that deeply. It looks completely different from anything we could imagine. The evangelist points us in a direction that we hadn't imagined. They tell us that God set up his royal throne in the manger in Bethlehem and at the cross on Calvary. Yes, even the grave becomes the place of the living God. This is how God wants to be known to the world, the living God in the lowly. The Danish author Axel Heltoft has written a short story called The Dungeon. The story takes place during the Second World War. A group of Jews and prisoners of war of different nationalities are stowed together under wretched conditions in a dungeon. Under these inhuman conditions, they are doing forced labor for the Germans. They are kept down by violence and terror of the German SS. One day, one of the German SS officers discovers that one of the prisoners is wearing a pair of the SS gloves. Where did he get them? They must have been stolen. And then begins a humiliating rebuke and punishment. The SS officer lectures the prisoner that it is a theft, that stealing is not allowed. For how would society be if everybody started stealing? The soldier stands there, furious and bellowing, hitting an emaciated, freezing prisoner while lecturing him that stealing is not allowed. The other prisoners are, of course, shocked at the humiliating treatment, but they do nothing. They are powerless and can only watch while the Russian prisoner is transformed into a bloody lump. Their own dignity has been taken away from them so thoroughly that they are paralyzed and can only watch as guilty of not intervening. Yes, it is a cruel, depressing story. However, it has a strange ending which has to be included. An ending which only a writer and poet is allowed. In the story, it happens, quite unmediated, that Jesus turns up in the raw and wretched dungeon. Everything changes and is explained. In a moment filled by the weight and transfiguration of eternity, even the Nazi officer is brought to a stop. Without one word being spoken, everybody knows that evil, the devilish mechanism of lying, has been broken. It is stopped. Not by itself, but from outside, so to speak, in an intervention. In the midst of human despair, in this slavery under the forces of darkness, in an infinite moment, they meet something else, something different. Jesus. No one there doubts who it is. And Jesus goes over to the beaten Russian Jew, bends down, catches his eye, and kisses the swollen face. In the midst of suffering and terror, the wretch is looked at with love. God is also here. That is what separates Christianity from all other religions. It offers us no easy explanation as to why there is evil in the world and in us. Evil is here. Darkness is close. But the world has not been abandoned by God. Christianity speaks of God in lowly places. It speaks of God showing us who he is through the human life that starts in a stable and ends on a cross. This is how much God wants us. Not only has he given us life, but he is also willing to go all the way with us, even through death and the grave and darkness. Dear congregation, we are on our way to Easter, the greatest feast of Christianity. We are on our way to the feast of life. But it is not without darkness and death. There is no way to Easter morning beyond the pain of Good Friday, not even for the Lord of the Church. We hear it through the Gospel of today. Jesus is anointed like a king, but also as one would anoint a dead body. Mary exalts him and praises him because his speech is truthful and can carry through even in the hardest hours. Why? Because Mary has seen him cry when her brother Lazarus was dead. Jesus cried. He acknowledged the human pain, and he spoke his word into the dark tomb of death, not surpassing it. He spoke his word, "Lazarus, come out." The Gospel of John has the duality all the way through. To begin with the elevation of Jesus is his elevation on the cross in the Gospel of John. The self-testimony of Christ in the Gospel of John is with the old name of God, "I am," like God the Lord revealed himself to Moses in the burning bush. I am the living God. Yahweh is the old name of God, which means I am. This name is what Jesus proclaims. I am, he says, I am the good shepherd. I am the resurrection and the life. I am. Here is the living God. Everything gathers in him. Here the living God reveals who he is and always has been. The creator and Lord of the universe, who wants a fragile human being, you and me, so much that he will bear all costs for us, even sin and death. His life, death, and resurrection show us that this brief human life has eternal meaning. For us, this never really comes together while we are on our way. The briefness of life, the limitation of life, and then the joy and thankfulness of eternity. But that which we cannot hold together, he holds together for us. Therefore, we dare hope. Therefore, we dare rejoice. Therefore, we dare anticipate Easter morning, a day, a time, by the grace of God, where everything that wears us down and troubles us shall be taken away. Yes, where even death itself shall stand as the loser. Christ has shown us himself, and he shows us exactly therefore also toward our poor neighbor, whom we always have with us. Behold the man. Behold your sister, and your brother. Our Lord will not be without the least of these. It is this astonishing fact that is the reason for Mary's humble acceptance and gift, and the reason why we are gathered here today to sing, to thank, and to praise God. This is why Christianity differs. God wants us so much that he wants to live our lives with us. The real life, where we humans laugh and cry, suffer and die. The real life with doubts and scruples, with evil and hard-heartedness. Yes, he wants us so much that he will go all the way, also to death, darkness, and horror, for us and with us. This is the Christian gospel, the joyous message. This is why we build churches. They are built to his honor, the crucified and resurrected, he who can contain our whole human life with all it entails. Without this house, we would be poor, even if we owed everything. We wouldn't have a place to go when our hearts were bursting with thanks, when we can find no words for our joy. We come here with our children because there is no better place for them to be than in the hand of God. The bridal couple kneels here in thanks and praise for their marriage. And yes, we come here when our hearts are filled with sorrow, with a coffin in our midst, and listen to the words that speak against death's triumph. Speak of hope where all hope seems to be abandoned and death has closed our mouths. That is why we build churches. Let us thank and praise our Lord and God, who bends down to the world to begin with us again, and everything from yesterday erased. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, amen.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Wild and extravagant God, in the same way Mary of Bethany poured costly ointment on your Son, make us a people whose lives are wasted in love, not in caution. Stir in us a sense of your generous life, given freely and with reckless abandon, so that we may learn to become more like you. Give us the eyes to see the things we have not been able to see before. Embolden us in the times we long to offer the whole of ourselves for something beautiful or crazy or ridiculous. And give us the courage to follow where you lead without regard to cost. Pour your love on those who know deep poverty and who long to be at the receiving end of another's extravagant offering. Draw near to us who long to be seen and known and loved, but who so often continue to feel we are invisible. Invisible to you, invisible to the world, and even invisible to ourselves, except as we see ourselves through distorted insecurities. Lord, in your mercy. Compassionate and persevering God, your servant Paul tells us to strain forward to what lies ahead and to press on for your heavenly call. We bring before you all those who are unable to envision any future toward which to strain, any who have seen their lives and livelihoods evaporate, for those who are facing the heartbreaking loss of a marriage or relationship, for any who have lost jobs, and for all those whose days are too often filled with terror and violence, including the people of Syria and Afghanistan. Grant your strength and perseverance to those who press on in the journey of faith, but find themselves worn, weary, and bewildered at where the journey has brought them. On this day, we celebrate the life of St. Patrick. We remember before you Ireland and Northern Ireland. Heal the wounds of all those who continue to live in the midst of long-held troubles and religious conflict there. We also ask your grace upon the Roman Catholic brothers and sisters in our lives in this season of transition, and pour your Holy Spirit on the newly elected Pope Francis as he leads the Roman Catholic Church in this age. Lord, in your mercy. Nurturing and loving God, we lift up to your care new parents and newborn children. Infuse with your joy and patience all who are encountering their first days as a parent. Provide comfort and support to any who feel nervous and uncertain over how to care for a new child. Protect with your grace any mothers who find themselves struggling with depression and sadness instead of anticipated joy. Cherish all infants whose arrival has not been met with joy and anticipation, but anxiety or grief or separation. Be with mothers who feel alone and afraid and who are making decisions around adoption. Wrap your arms around fathers who may feel helpless in the face of another's decisions. Be with those parents who eagerly await adoption but have had their hopes dashed again and again. We remember children whose lives are spent within the foster care system and pray that they may know homes of support and care. Be with all children who long to know stability and love, but instead find themselves living in places of neglect and abuse. Lord, in your mercy. Christ, our light, illumine us. Christ, be with us, before us, behind us. Christ, in us, beneath us, above us. Christ, on our right and on our left. Christ, in every eye that sees us. Christ, in every ear that hears us. Blessed Trinity, bind to us as we bind ourselves to you. Eternal Father, Spirit, and Word. Amen. All of today's offerings will go to Duke Chapel Pathways, which is the primary way that we reach out to Duke's undergraduate students. Let us offer our gifts to the work of God's kingdom. Thank you.
Please be seated. If you are here today with a special need and you would like a minister to pray with you or for you, there will be ministers in the memorial chapel there ready to pray with you. Would you please stand again? The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Almighty God, good Father to us all, your face is turned towards your world. In love, you gave us Jesus, your Son, to rescue us from sin and death. Your word goes out to call us home to the city where angels sing your praise. And so we watch for the signs of your kingdom on earth. We gladly thank you with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven singing the hymn of your unending praise. Healing Lord, we give you thanks for every gift that comes from heaven. Into the darkness Jesus came as your light. With signs of faith and words of hope, he touched untouchables with love and washed the guilty clean. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who on the night that he was betrayed, took the bread and gave thanks to you and broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And at that same meal, he took the cup and he gave thanks to you and gave it to his disciples and said, "This is the covenant shed in my blood for the forgiveness of sins. Drink it and do this in remembrance of me." Great is the mystery of faith. Send your Spirit on us now, that by these gifts we may feed on Christ with opened eyes and hearts on fire. May we and all who share this food offer ourselves to live for you and be welcomed at your feast in heaven, where all creation worships you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Christ broke open his life for us, that we may be made whole in him. The table is set and ready. Come, taste and see that the Lord is indeed good. Thank you.
Please stand. Let us pray. Strengthen for service, Lord, the hands that have taken holy things. May the ears which have heard your word be deaf to clamor and dispute. May the tongues which have sung your praise be free from deceit. May the eyes which have seen your love shine with the light of hope. And may the bodies which have been fed with your body be refreshed with the fullness of your life, that we may continually give thanks to you for our lives, our work, for Duke and Durham, this city and university, and all the many things unspoken, for gifts unknown or as of yet unseen, for these and all thy gifts of love, we give thee thanks, O God. Amen. This service is ended, but our worship continues. And may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forever. Amen.